You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Restorative Justice and Peacebuilding. I will be broadcasting this weekly show as part of a class that I'm teaching at Cal State Dominguez Hills, where I am a professor of negotiation, conflict resolution, and peacebuilding. Before I introduce my guest for today, Colonel Singh, I would like to briefly introduce Restorative Justice and Peacebuilding to all those watching. My students will be calling and writing in, but since we broadcast throughout Los Angeles and LA counties, I welcome all of you to come in, join our studio audience the next 11 Mondays from 4 to 5, email me, do whatever you need to do to learn more about this important field. Okay, let me turn to my introductory PowerPoint. Restorative justice and peacebuilding is obviously a very broad topic, and I will be introducing how complex it is today. But in general, I would say that speaking truth to power in these very ugly times in the United States and in various parts of the world is another way of talking about catalyzing needed social justice against all odds. And peacebuilding is the broader category. Today we will actually be talking a bit about war and peace and what most people imagine when they think of peacebuilding. But everything we teach in negotiation and conflict resolution helps with the very complex, complicated task of peace building. Restorative justice is a more narrow category, but at the same time involves both the international level of peace building as well as all the criminal justice systems throughout California, throughout the United States, and throughout the world. Let me say more. But first of all, I would like to introduce my community. And if you've never visited us in the South Bay of California, in the southern tip of Los Angeles County, I welcome you. We have recently been ranked number two in the CSU, in the Cal State University system, for return on investment by Money Magazine. We are in the top 50 of all colleges and universities in the nation for return on investment. I'm very proud of that, that we are not only helping students afford a college education, but we're doing it without burying them in impossible debt. And they're graduating from our university and getting really good jobs. We were ranked recently number four among California colleges for advancing students economically. Many of our students are first-generation college students, like my own parents. And we're number eighth in the U.S. for Latino-Latina degrees. So we have a lot to be proud of. We are considered one of the most diverse universities west of the Mississippi. I'm going to talk about the faculty staff community and then focus on our students. Last time we tallied languages, there were over 60 different languages spoken at Dominguez Hills. 36% of our staff and our faculty, our community, are foreign born. 29% are white, 13.2% Asian. Let's go to our students. As I said earlier, we're one of the leading Latino-Latina institutions in the United States, 64% of our students. You know, similar to the composition percentage in California and the Western states. 13% of our students are African-American, and we're actually seen as a historic black college as well. 10% of our students Asian Pacific Islander, and I'm definitely in the minority with our faculty, staff, students, students 9% white. Okay, let me talk about restorative justice. I have been a victim offender mediator for over 25 years. And as you will hear throughout my show, I'm very passionate about victim offender mediation, particularly with first-time juvenile offenders. I started doing my victim offender mediation with juvenile offenders, primarily Spanish-speaking offenders in Colorado. And the research that I saw coming out of Colorado showed it was the most powerful intervention in preventing recidivism or repeat crime. So if you really want to help first-time young offenders, child, teen offenders, get to know about and learn how to offer them victim offender mediation. I have also been a mediator for 30 years and have used mediation with repeat violent offenders, again, juveniles ages 10 to 17, and the use of mediation dramatically reduced their violent behavior over 50% in less than 6 months. Now, I'm going to switch over to peacebuilding. Now, most of you, as I mentioned earlier, are going to imagine what we call negative peace, the absence of war, the absence of violence, a strong defense and deterrent. But actually, in the field of peacebuilding, positive peace is as, if not more important than negative peace. And that includes building peace within prayer, meditation, yoga, positive thinking, whatever it is that you use to build peace within, we include that. We certainly include all of the organizations and societal systems where we find violence, such as the family, sadly, with domestic violence and child abuse, but also organizations and communities. By teaching our students relationship, communication, and creative, collaborative problem solving and restorative skills, they are learning how to build cultures of peace while transforming, eradicating cultures of violence. To help you understand how this all works, if you're new to our field, I'm going to quickly introduce the levels of conflict resolution and peacebuilding, and I will repeat these next week. Our students, hopefully, are already acquainted. But most of us think, when we hear peacebuilding, we think of the top level, the international level, the level of international law, military, governance such as the United Nations. But actually, I would like to start at the very bottom level. And our guest speaker today is going to be addressing both the bottom level and the very top. Because really, if we think about it, every international system includes thousands, millions of individuals. And so how they are as people matters. Our inner moral lives, our values matter. That's the very bottom. Now, if I had had enough room to include the interpersonal level as well as the intrapersonal level, we'd be talking about, you know, conversations between individuals, negotiations between individuals. That would be the second level here. The next level is the group level. That includes our families, our cultures. What goes on within our groups is critically important too. If there's violence within our families, we are going to be spreading violence outward. While if there is a culture of peace and dignity in our families, that's going to permeate everything as well. And then what goes on between groups is critically important, as we see with cultural groups. Now, there is a movement right now to educate human beings that via DNA, we are all one people. You know, Bob Marley and One Love, well, he was on to something scientifically. I think the research shows that something like 92 to 93% of our DNA is shared. We are more alike than we are different, but we are constantly creating war and conflict based on color of skin, gender, all the differences that we view. So that's a critical level. Now, the next level are our complex systems, and that also includes the family, because families are generational, and they do have complex traditions and systems. It includes all our organizations and all of our communities. Everything we do in NCRP, in our interdisciplinary field, must consider all of these levels. Okay, enough of a quick introduction for you. I am now very happy to introduce my first guest speaker, who I will be interviewing today. We are very fortunate to have a retired colonel with us today who can speak to some of the bigger issues and concerns of war and peace in the world today, as well as terrorism. And at the same time, he retired from his service as a military officer in the Army to study spiritual life, to teach breathwork and meditation. So he's wonderfully qualified to talk about inner peace building as well. I am very happy to introduce to all of you Colonel Swaranjeet Singh. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Nancy, for having me.
I heard you speak at the NCRP Cyber Conference last spring, and the theme was Veterans for Peace. At that time, and also, you know, the other time I heard you say something like this is when Professor of Education Anthony Normore and I were editing a book on international leadership, and Professor Normore asked you to write the preface to our collection on international leadership. You said the same thing then, that you think nation states are going to start to be a thing of the past, disappearing, that we're going to see borders and boundaries merge, dissolve. Can you say more about that?
See, the nation states have already started disappearing. See the quantum leap in cell phone technology and internet social platforms like Facebook and Twitter, where people are communicating in real-time world, okay, in real-time exchange of ideas and communication, and the boundaries are already broken. Mm. If you compare the situation, let's say 15 to 20 years back, when the nation states could restrict the communication between international citizens or citizens of their country with the communicating with the outside citizens. Mm. So the evolution of breaking of these boundaries have already started. The way we are exchanging communications, regardless of our nationalities, basically to respond to a political or a social situation, it's already happening.
Yes, we are very connected.
For example, the response to Me Too movement is international. It broke all national boundaries. Mm. It was not limited to USA or to a particular country. All women across the nation, across the globe, you know, participated in this movement and shared their experience.
Yes.
So this is one recent example of people breaking the national boundaries and coming together on a social platform and exchanging ideas in real time. See, as we lose our national identities, we'll also create new identities. Actually, the process is already happening. It may not be that tangible right now, but we have already started moving in this direction.
Well, our youth, and you just spoke to one of my classes of freshmen here at Dominguez, talking to them about how they can mobilize social movements for change via the internet and all of this, you know, technology. Our youth are saying things like they are gender fluid, and from what I hear you saying, maybe in the future they will be saying, I'm a global citizen, I am nation fluid, I'm not, you know, I'm not as rigid or defined as my parents or my grandparents. Now, if you don't mind, I also saw you speak out very passionately, and you resonated with the Native American veteran that was at our conference when you spoke out against the military-industrial complex and how the military-industrial complex profits, makes money off of the backs of the poor and the powerless of the world. Can you say more about that?
See, the military-industrial complex at a national level, President Eisenhower actually addressed this subject in his farewell speech to the nation in 1961.
Yes, very eloquently.
He basically said that we have to be careful of the immense power military-industrial complex wields over the nation. And he even cautioned the citizens that a stage may come that it may endanger your liberties and democratic institutions. See, what is the basic role of military-industrial complex? It is for profit and to sell wars and sell weapons. It is not to create a peaceful society or to help social causes. It's a ruthless nexus, I'll call it. It's an unholy, or I can even go to the extent of saying it's an incestual alliance between politicians, military, and the defense industry.
Okay. You spoke out about how the young of all countries can be manipulated and exploited by this military-industrial complex.
See, when we talk about the military-industrial complex is basically selling wars, stage managing wars for trial of future weapons, all for profit. And who all are profiting in this system, in this military-industrial complex? The politicians are benefiting. How? They get campaign donations. They get kickbacks. The ex-politicians who have become lobbyists, they benefit. They are on the payroll of the defense companies and corporations as consultants. They write the legislations to be passed in the Congress. Then what happens is the cost is controlled by the of the weapons is controlled by the military-industrial, the inflated cost. And that's where they pay the bribes and the kickbacks to the lobbyists and to the people who are influencing the decision-making.
Now, I want to make sure my students and our viewers understand. Don't misunderstand you, because, you know, I know India and the U.S. have some of the strongest militaries in the world. And I know you think a strong military is important defense, that if a country lacks a strong military, they might be vulnerable to attack. So say more about, you know, you've lived in this world, so you see the complexity of it.
See, there is no military solution to any problem.
Yes.
There is no military. Ultimately, there has to be a political and a social solution to any problems. If you solve problems by military solutions, there'll be more violence. Violence begets more violence. If you have violence, if you have wars, there will be more wars. Eventually, even if you have a war or you use military as a deterrent, eventually political solutions have to be found.
Yeah, you cannot rely. No, the last two decades of the U.S., invading Iraq, fighting continually in Afghanistan, and even though we haven't been that involved in Syria, I think Americans are getting a clear image of what you're saying, that war and the military cannot solve the problems. They must be used in limited ways, strategically, or not at all.
I'll give another recent example of military-industrial complex. After 9/11, there were 19 hostages, the terrorists, who were responsible for the 9/11. For the downing of the towers. And we attacked Afghanistan, and then we attacked Iraq. We had lost close to 3,000 citizens. And in the process, between both the wars, we have lost about about 6,000 to 7,000 U.S. military men, and we have killed over 1 million to 1.5 million total civilians and military in both the countries, depending on which source you reach out to get the figures. Mm. So what did we achieve is basically to take revenge by declaring war on terror onto Afghanistan, where out of the 19 terrorists, 15 were from Saudi Arabia.
Mm.
And the excuse to attack Iraq was that they have weapons of mass destruction, and that turned out to be a false foundation, false assessment by the intelligence agencies. So I see a hand and role of military industrial complex in some way in these wars being launched, created, and managed.
Mm.
Another example is, like, even very recently under President Trump also, we tested one of the biggest, largest conventional bomb called Mother of All Bombs. And we tested it in Afghanistan. It has an explosive content in the explosive. It has about 19,000 pounds of explosive. It's the largest conventional weapon. And it's carried out by a big aircraft, transport aircraft. It dropped by parachutes. And you can imagine the colossal, damage it will cause. It can destroy caves or underground caves up to 500 feet.
Mm.
So when this was launched, the president of Afghanistan, Karzai, he said, this is not war against terror. You're using a poor country to test your own weapon systems. This is ruthless.
Mm.
So, these are the examples of indirect influence of military industrial complex to cause war and even to stage manage where these new weapons are tested, because eventually these weapons will be marketed and sold to the military of the US and other militaries for profit. So in this process, all benefit: the politicians, the decision makers, the lawmakers, the military, and the defense industries.
Though arguably, and we don't have time to explore this, but things have gotten worse. Terrorism, insurgencies, it's all gotten worse rather than better. And, I have several students, and some will likely be viewing this, if not now, at another time, who have enlisted in the U.S. military, all the different branches, or are serving right now. I also have several students in this class who hope to become law enforcement. And I have had relatives go to West Point. I have known the best and the worst of police officers. I mean, I'm going to assume they all have an intent, a sincere intent to serve. Now, during very corrupt and troubled, problematic times, I hadn't mentioned this to you earlier, but this morning I was emailing back and forth with the faculty at the U.S. War College for the Navy. And I was saying, many of my students who've served in the military over the last decade have said traditional warfare just is not working. They need to do something differently to connect with the communities that are maybe being held hostage by terrorists, all sorts of things. And she reassured me that they are doing deep reflection about strategy and mission. But I must say, given the corruption that permeates the U.S. and the Indian political systems, I think it's very tough to be serving right now. What would you say my students should look for in a leader, a military law enforcement leader?
Firstly, I want to bring home a point that who are the people who are joining militaries? Like, who are the people? Where do these, who are the students, who are the young men who are joining U.S. Army or other armies around the world?
The troops on the ground, yes.
I'm talking about basically enlisted men,
yes.
The privates.
Yes.
The foot soldiers.
And women.
The foot soldiers,
yes.
The lowest levels. See, the poorest, the people from the poorest strata of society are joining military.
Mm.
They want a job. And there may be a small percentage who are joining military to get the college money, but basically people from poor families are joining the military.
Mm.
And the same thing is happening in the other countries. Mm. So when war happens, who is killing? The poor people or the poorest people of one nation, is they are killing the poorest people of the other nation.
Mm. Yes.
And I want to bring out another casualty factor. Is 90% of all war casualties are, in addition to the soldiers, are women and children, mm-hmm. and who have no idea why this war is being caused.
Mm.
Even the foot soldiers have no idea why the war is caused.
No, they don't. They're following their leaders. They're
19, 20, 21 years old, and they are just sucked into the system, and this is a hard reality of time. Regarding the qualities of a leader.
Excuse me for interrupting, but we've seen some very corrupt U.S. officers recently. You look at the current administration, and some of the scandals have involved generals and other officers. So, you know, that puts someone serving, an enlisted man or woman, in a very difficult position if there might be a corrupt, profit-hungry person. So what should they look for in a leader to trust that person?
What you said is right. Military is part of the beneficiary in a military industrial complex.
Yes.
I'm talking about the top military leadership. They
yes.
are the beneficiaries.
Yes.
As far as qualities, I can list 100 qualities which are ideally needed in a leader. It can be courage, accountability, or team spirit, loyalty to organization.
Loyalty to their well-being?
No, I wanted to emphasize.
Yeah.
See, one quality we often discuss is loyalty, even in political system, loyalty to the next leader.
Mm.
But I feel the loyalty should be to the constitution, to the country.
To the ideals,
and to
the principles.
To the rule of law, and not to the superior or the next leader who may be corrupt. It has to be morally correct, which is enshrined in the constitutions and the values and the rules which are set up in the military system.
No, many Americans would agree with you. For example, if a police officer was to discover, and I've had many police officers as students in NCRP, if they were to discover that one of their colleagues was involved in drug trafficking or criminal activity, they have a professional obligation to figure out how to do the right thing. There's a professional independence that is asked. Now, it's a little different in the military, where you're under pressure, you're supposed to follow the leader.
There is inherent tendency in all institutions, military or police, to protect the people.
Mm.
I feel that...
criminal people.
Even if they are...
Yes.
My point is,
yes.
protecting is fine as far as within the domain of the laws.
Mm.
But protecting the criminal, the corrupt elements, it happens all the time. I think we need more oversight and reforms in that direction.
We need to help those who are in the difficult spot.
And one out of all, I can list like 20 traits and the leadership qualities which are ideally required. You can all put in all the good things which are needed.
Right.
But I will emphasize on one main quality which is really needed, and it is to lead by personal example and lead from the front, where you expose yourself equally to the threat along with the foot soldiers, and not just give orders and use the foot soldiers as fodder.
Yeah, no, powerfully said. I would agree. I would hope. Now, the other part of this, well, before I go into it, I know you deeply respected John McCain. Can you tell me a bit of that respect? What did you respect?
See, John McCain was from a very illustrious military family.
Mm.
His father was a four-star admiral.
Right.
His grandfather was a four-star admiral.
Amazing.
In the Navy.
Yes.
Okay. And then he joined the Naval Academy, and he got commissioned, and he was a fighter pilot. And he was very brutally honest in so many ways. For example, he made sure that every time he talked about his academy, he made sure that people knew that he was one of the second last or the lowest in the merit when he passed out from the the Naval Academy.
No, he let people know.
Okay. But during the Vietnamese War, his aircraft was shot. He was taken. He was a prisoner of war, and he was tortured. He was tortured to the extent that he couldn't lift his arm still for the rest of his life. And when the Vietnamese learned that he's the son of a serving admiral in the U.S. Navy, they offered him a chance, and he refused. He said, "I'll go as per the code, the first in, first out, regardless of my status. So I will take my place in the queue to get out." So that was worth appreciating. And the other thing is when he came back, he retired from the Navy as a captain, and that is 1981. And then he moved to Arizona, and then he had two terms as a U.S. representative. And then this was his sixth term as a senator. So he was the longest, one of the longest serving senators. And even in his death, he joined the nation on the principles of morality and truth to power, and stand up to the bullies and speak the truth, regardless of that person, the high position or the power he holds. That if you see that lies and immorality, it is your right, fundamental right as a gentleman or as a representative or as a citizen, to stand up and challenge and speak against that.
Yes. Well, and that really jumps into my next question about what you would recommend citizens do to confront and transform the corruption in India's politics, government, as well as the U.S. Now, the U.S., many Americans don't know this, but Transparency International studies corruption and publicizes corruption. And because we have not been able to implement political campaign finance reform, our politics are some of the most corrupt in the world. But sadly, our healthcare system is close behind because of sweet deals between pharmaceutical medical equipment companies and physicians. Very sad. It's almost like our medical healthcare industry is starting to mirror some of the military-industrial complex dynamic.
Yes, I agree.
What would you say citizens of India and the U.S. need to do to confront and transform what we're currently seeing?
I can list you many reasons or many reforms which can improve the situation. But the fundamentally I'll focus is that you need the political will to kill this problem.
Say more about that.
For example, like Lokpal in India or some independent body or ombudsman.
Yes.
Who can investigate the powerful, the arms of the law and the enforcement agencies cannot touch the powerful people, the governors, the presidents, and the secretaries in the system.
No, so you do need an independent body.
So besides transparency and, reforms in political setup, you need these independent bodies who has oversight and who can ensure accountability and challenge these powerful people and book them for their crimes. And so that justice is...
Yes, exposed, just like our media, some of it is trying to do. Now, Sweden first created the Ombuds in the early 1900s to investigate citizen complaint against their own government, their own royalty. And actually, Brian Jarrett, who is the current director of NCRP, is currently at the American Ombudsman Association, where all the classical ombuds are coming together to talk about this. I totally agree with you, and some of our students and graduates will be able to do these independent investigations. Another version of this for police officers, citizen oversight panels, so that it's not fellow police officers investigating complaints, but people who truly want to see justice.
I agree. I can only reinforce with one more point is that, see, the systems, the current systems, the reforms are needed right now. See, we need reforms in a political setup. We reforms in law enforcement. We need reforms in finance and audit and empowering citizens for oversight, holding people, public servants, accountable. And this has to be based with the with the political will to enforce these reforms and implement them.
Well, and when you say political will, it means all of us. All of us need to do our part.
I agree. Yes. Besides involvement of the community and the local law enforcement, we need the direction right from the heads of our governments.
Yes,
at
we
various
do.
Levels, state, and city.
I have not seen it for a couple of decades. Now, military leadership, I know this since I grew up with some of this, traditionally has prized both athletic, physical, and academic intellectual excellence. That's the model, the masculine ideal. We still have time to get to the remainder of the questions. More and more of the men in the U.S., American men, young men, and Dominguez Hills is a good example, are rejecting and abandoning higher education. I hope they're not pursuing crime and violence, but it's women who are primarily going on to college and university. What are your thoughts about motivating young men to become their best, their most ethical, effective best? What would you say if you were talking to the youngest of men?
I see, firstly, we have to pinpoint the exact problem areas in the communities. Mm. Like, is it, like, what kind of problem we have? Is it broken homes?
Mm. Yes.
Is it utter
violence
poverty?
Violence in the home, yes.
Is it the community infested by gang violence?
Mm, mm.
Is it drugs in that area?
Mm.
Is it lack of parks and other recreational facilities in that area?
Mm.
Where there is no recreational facilities available to the local youth in that area.
Mm.
So fundamentally, we have to identify the problems. And then we can take preventive measures in the sense by provision of facilities.
Meeting their needs when they're children.
Like we have to create, we have to give education to the local community leaders and facilities so they can handle these young kids at their community level and at their school levels.
Mm.
And basically it needs effort by the government at various level by provisioning of funds so that the facility, ideal environment is created for these people. For example, if people are homeless, the state or the city should be able to provide these people with some kind of living so that they can progress and grow into good citizens and contribute to the society.
Well, I'll tell you, in my lifetime as an American citizen, we have failed again and again with children. This research shows 1 in 4, 1 in 5 are abused. They're victims of violence. They see violence in their homes. They're victims of violence in their community. And we continue, we have these religious political debates about sex education and blah, blah, blah. Children continue, and Carson has more foster children than any other community I've lived. Those are the children who have been removed from or don't have biological parents and need to grow up with other parents, and emancipated youth who've never really had the care that children deserve. But we continue to promote, having children that are uncared for. So this is a really vicious cycle in this country.
I feel we have to focus on the basic, crux of this problem. How to make a happy, functional family.
Mm.
Because that's where the problem, the kids come, and that's where the problem starts. You're talking about abuse. Yes, sexual, emotional, social, physical.
Right.
These kind of abuses are happening en masse, all over. Right?
All over the world. Okay. There is no country protecting women from violence.
Okay. But then normally the other angle is, why I'm saying is focus on, educating and giving more, facilities or environment, creation of environment so that happy families function and live and create happy kids. Because most of the abusers normally, I believe more than 90-95% of abusers are known to the victim. They are relatives, uncles, husbands.
Mm.
you know, yes. brothers, sisters.
Sad, yes.
So we have to create a happy, functioning family unit with education and creation of other facilitative environment.
Well, maybe switching over to inner peace building will help with answering the question, how families might create happy families. You know, I think Americans, my family immigrated to this country in the 1900s from Norway. They had a very good life in Norway, but Norway has harsh conditions. The men in my family were on ships. They were captains of ships. It was very hard living. So they came here for a better life. But generally, Americans have defined that happy, better life as material things rather than inner peace through prayer and meditation. Now, you were born and raised in India, and you retired from the military to do more spiritual studies, if I understand correctly. What motivated that? That's quite a switch from colonel to meditation.
You know, one is you have to have basic means to pursue spiritual path, I feel.
Oh, that's true. Basic if you're food
stuck,
and
if you're
safety.
Stuck into day-to-day survival, you cannot have the opportunity to pursue spiritual path. I took my early retirement with full pension. Then I went through a bitter divorce. And that could have helped me into this direction where I pursued a spiritual path. I visited various masters. I lived in ashrams.
Well, you were in India. Now,
yes.
I do want to interrupt. In my experience of the poor of the United States, many Catholics are very, very devout, church-going people. They will go to churches, to the Catholic Mass, several times a day to pray. So sometimes the poor are are some of the most spiritual people. But I do agree with you, it helps to have enough food, a shelter, some safety. Okay, so you went through a very heart-wrenching, hard time, and you went to ashrams in India seeking some peace, some healing.
So I learned these breathwork techniques. It's nothing to do with any religion. It's a physical exercise where you control your breath. Like the emotions of sudden happiness and sorrow affect your happiness. So sudden emotions of sorrow and happiness also affect your state of mind and how you breathe. It directly affects your breathing pattern. And the logic of this is that when you control your breath, you control your state of happiness or you control your state of being.
Mm.
It's a very simple analogy. Like, you know, you control your breath, you control your state of happiness.
Well, I must say, learning to take a deep breath and relax is an easy way to understand that. Now, my first husband became a Buddhist priest. I've lived in ashrams. I've lived in Franciscan contemplative communities. That's Catholic contemplative. I very much believe in the power of prayer and meditation for building inner peace, because our minds tend to be so, as the Japanese teacher I knew would say, monkey minds. Yeah, they're constantly running around. And now with cell phones and technology, I'm afraid there's addictions happening where people will never take a breath, never calm down, never know what it feels like to feel peaceful. What's it like for you when you, now you both do breath work and you teach breath work.
On a select basis, not on a commercial basis.
Okay. What's it like for you to do these breathing techniques? Does it help you feel peace?
Oh, yes, of course. It calms you. It's an exercise. It calms your
your
mind and you
it
are serene, you feel
yeah.
happy. I can give an equivalent example. It's just like on a nice day, you climb a mountain and when you reach the mountain top, there's a tree, you sit under the shade of the tree and drink cold water and you feel calm and you feel happy. It's something like that. It's a physical exercise. Breathing is a physical exercise of the mind and it calms the mind. It's very simple.
Well, and I will say to my students, I learned to meditate when my father would take me fishing because we would go out on the water, and of course he would say, be quiet, you'll scare the fish. So I had to be quiet and pay attention and breathe, and that's basically what it is. So it's something you enjoy doing.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's like you play golf, it's meditative. So it's just like a activity which calms you and takes you to a meditative and a calmer state.
Yes. You know, Father Merton, Thomas Merton, was a Catholic monk who very much fell in love with Buddhist meditation. He introduced contemplative prayer to Catholics because I think he felt prayer, you know, is basically talking to whoever you believe in. But meditation is actually becoming peaceful. And in the Christian religion, we talk about the peace that passes all understanding. We define our, you know, God as peace. So meditation is an important part of feeling and knowing God, peace. I try to do it most days. It really helps me.
I agree. See, when your mind is calmer, your comprehension increases, you know?
Yes. Well, it helps me. I'll talk about being a mediator and a negotiator. Mm-hmm. I have been asked to mediate where people, minorities, are very, very angry because they see white government as discriminating against them. And in my opinion, they've got very valid concerns because, you know, there's a lot of discrimination in this country. Some of the prejudice and hatred is getting even worse. But I've been asked to mediate with very, very angry people who need to talk for an hour or more to feel like they really express themselves. Meditation has helped me just open my mind and listen to them so that I'm present for them. It's a great tool for NCRP.
I agree, and the whole world is recognizing that. See the popularity of yoga. See the meditative and yoga classes. It is being conducted all over the world in most of the prisons and jails.
Yes.
The classes of mindfulness classes is taught as an interdisciplinary subject all over the world now.
Yes.
So this awakening is happening and people are understanding and using these tools to stay calmer. Because there are too many distractions in this world, like, you know.
Well, and we need to get calm to become our best selves rather than our worst selves. Now, prisons are a place where both restorative justice, helping prisoners repair the damage they've done to people in the outer world, and meditation have caught fire. Yes, there are many, many prisons where prisoners are meditating as well as writing letters to their victims, trying to repair harm. You have taught breathwork and meditation in our local women's prison.
Yes.
How was that? Were they enthusiastic?
Yes, they were very happy and they were very responsive, and they enjoyed the activity and the discipline and the session I put them through.
How did they say it helped them? Did they say?
Of course, you can see the cheerfulness and peaceful state of the person when you look at them.
Well, sure, they're smiling and they're relaxed. You just did this with my freshman.
Okay.
And we met one of the young men on campus, and he was more relaxed than I normally see him. He was happier. It was wonderful. Now, I guess today being my very first broadcast in class, I'm not getting some of the call-in questions, comments. I'm saying it right now because we have 9 minutes left of our broadcast, and I want to encourage, if there are any students out there or any community members who have questions or concerns, please send them call in immediately before we end our broadcast. Now, depending on your interest, I may be inviting Colonel Singh back. I don't have that many guests who are going to talk about the international level of peace building. I do have a Kenyan alumni who will come and talk about restorative justice, truth and reconciliation in Kenya. But otherwise, I'm going to have primarily people who have started victim offender mediation programs throughout LA and Orange County and are working specifically in the schools to help eradicate the horrific violence as well as the dropout rate. It's, you know, really, it's like our prison situation. You punish children by kicking them out of school and they didn't even want to go to school in the first place to get an education. We're really shooting ourselves in the foot and creating bad problems, making them worse by our choices. Now, I would like to introduce Negotiation Alchemy is my second book. And for those of you interested in international peacebuilding, it contains all my international work up to a certain point, including a chapter co-authored with students of NCRP from several African nations. So you can get this at Amazon.com. I recommend it to you. I also want to introduce a book I co-edited with Colonel Singh, Creating a Sustainable Vision of Nonviolence in Schools and Society. This book has been so popular that we're being asked to update it. And we have authors from around the world that have contributed chapters. I have a past as a school lawyer, and I particularly would like to hear from people who share my passion for ending school violence, though violence against women and children and exploiting the poor, those are also passions of mine. Okay, we just have a little bit more than 5 minutes left. I know you, this is the last book I'll introduce to my students. Colonel Singh really admired Epictetus. I don't know if any of you have read his The Art of Living, but he was a slave who so impressed his owners with his philosophy of living and his brilliance that he essentially won his own liberation. And I would recommend this for anyone interested in studying virtue, happiness, and effectiveness. I know you're a real fan. You actually introduced me to this book years ago. What most impressed you about Epictetus, his philosophy of living? And, you know, we have like 5 minutes, so if you want to relate it to your own philosophy, that's fine.
See, he was born in 55 AD. In the Roman Empire, and he was a born slave. Mm. Imagine the hardship and the humility and the discrimination he must have suffered as a slave. He got his freedom when Emperor Nero, how you say it, he died, and then he got, and then the next emperor banished all philosophers from Roman Empire, and he had to move.
Oh, that's right. He went in exile.
He had to move to, you know, Greece to open a philosophy schools, and one of the prominent people and politicians of the time were his students. And there are, even the US military is well aware of Epictetus and its teachings, and the vice presidential candidate of Ross Perot, Scottsdale,
right,
the naval pilot, he said Epictetus helped him to undergo the torture of imprisonment while as a POW, prisoner of war in Vietnam. Mm. It is his teaching that he could sustain and come out successfully. Mm. So I'll sum up Epictetus. He basically said, if the things are beyond your control, don't stress, accept them. Mm. He basically said, live a simple life of morality and try to seek happiness in that. Mm. Make a compromise and try to seek a happiness. Basically, his fundamental philosophy was founded on morality and good values.
Mm. Being at peace with oneself.
And he also gave a very good example of, like there is a person who's a very powerful person, say a judge, he's sitting in the seat of a judge. And there is a prisoner who's being tortured, he's in a prison cell. There's a seat for the judge to sit and there is a seat for the prisoner in the cell. Both are basically places. One is high and one is low as per society. But your state of mind can still be the same. The judge could be miserable and the prisoner in the cell could be happier
well,
than
that. Well, Katagiri Roshi, the Zen Buddhist teacher I knew from Japan, he would say one of the great delusions of humans is this whole superiority-inferiority game.
Yes.
He said it's all a delusion. We are all born equal, we die equal, but we constantly are playing that game in our heads. And then the guru that I studied with in the ashram would say, what Carl Jung made a topic of his study, and my students study in ethics, what you most fiercely criticize in the other is likely within.
It is your reflection.
Yes, they are a mirror. It's your reflection.
It is your reflection.
Yes. Well, we certainly need wise words of morality during these times. I was hoping somebody would call in or write in.
It's okay.
But, you know, sometimes the first class, they're still getting their books. They're still getting oriented to the class. Many of my students work from 4 to 5. But I may call you back later in the semester if they do watch this video, this show, and send me questions, concerns, interests.
Sure, if
you'd be willing, yes, if there's
an
interest. In our last few minutes, is there anything else you'd like to say to students of negotiation, conflict resolution, and peace building? Would you encourage young people to enlist in the military at this point in history?
See, it'll be their personal choice.
Well, of course, yes.
If they need the... If they are seeking just adventure, go for it. You have the college, get the college money and make a career out of it and progress in life. Nothing wrong with it.
No.
But then it'll be ultimately their choice and their temperament. Are they fit for this physical service, which demands physical, you know, standards.
Well, yeah. And emotional, you know, this is probably what I'm thinking. Many of our vets are coming back very deeply traumatized by serving in combat. As you said, they were young, 17, 18. They had no idea what they were signing up for.
Oh, no, we have more than 200,000 veterans who are suffering from PTSD.
Yes.
And trauma. And it's a fact of life. And the homelessness state of veteran is maximum.
Yes. Alcoholism and drug addiction, it's all very sad.
We need help to, you know, re-employ and, you know, redirect these veterans who have missed out on life to bring them into mainstream society as useful citizens as they were as veterans while protecting the nation. Yes, we need it.
Well, and one thing I'll say in closing is the service they can do is to share the realities of war like you have been sharing. Too few ever speak the truth about what really goes on in the trauma. And it's time that we never forget the tragic costs of war. Thank you.
Thank you
so much for joining us.
Thank you.